Celtic part for the past 7 years. He's a perfect professional. So why, after a magnificent career in Scotland, did it all end in tears? Helsingborg and Glasgow have much in common. Both have a seagoing heritage, and now both are home to Henrik Larsson. It was in Helsingborg that he was brought up by his father Francisco, a sailor from an island off the west coast of Africa, and his Swedish mother Eva. This is the production line for the Larssons of the future. Hogaborg's BK, the amateur club where Henrik first got his taste for the beautiful game at the tender age of six.
He was a little bit shy, but he always tried to win in everything. If you have asked him when he was 7 or 8 if he going to be successful, he had answered that, of course, I'd be a professional footballer when I am growing up. He was active, very active, always a glimpse in the eye. I don't think he was very fond of school, though, but he didn't. I believe he rather played football and went to the school bench.
Henrik lived there, those flats. I played mostly with his older brother because he was at my age, and then when Henrik started to get better, he came in the first squad, and then since then we have always been good friends.
The first coach Henrik has was Bengt Persson. He had a big influence in Henrik because he looked after him all the time and encouraged him to work hard. Henrik was nearly quitting when he was 14, 15 to play floorball instead. Floorball is an indoor hockey game we have here in Sweden. Bengt Persson succeeded to get Henrik to take the right decision to be a footballer instead.
So Celtic fans should be eternally grateful to Bengt Persson for saving young Henrik from a different kind of sporting life. Instead, he took a dreadlock holiday away from indoor hockey and a star was born.
Everybody told me and my club that we should really watch him because he could be something.
Jonas Dahlgren då för HIF och Henrik Larsson.
He was a wonderful player. I mean, he was really working for the team. And he always put the team in the first hand.
Malmö har spelat med libero i två matcher. Det gjorde man inte idag. Patrik Olsson.
Henrik's Chris Sutton at Helsingborg was former Benfica striker Mats Magnusson.
When I came, he got a good teacher, so I taught him a lot of scoring tricks. We stayed a lot of hours after the normal trainings, and he learned to look at the ball and how to attack the ball on the crossings. And today you see he's not very tall, but he's got the timing.
They were a stunning partnership, and Magnusson taught the young Larsson every trick in the book, including the hat variety.
Everybody speaks about Masse and Henke. It was, you remember Masse, Henke, it was the good time of Helsingborg. We didn't have a good defense, but we scored a lot of goals, so.
He had a lot of women or girls as his fans because everybody liked his hair when those young ladies were coming and looking at him. I really hope that they also were interested in football.
I took some hair of his special hair and cut it, and it looks like a cigar, and I keep it now as a souvenir, and where I keep it I don't tell you.
Och Henke Larsson. Och det här målet kan ingen ta ifrån.
In the early 90s, football in Sweden was on the up and a popular place for talent spotting.
The first time I saw him playing was a game in Sweden. I went for scouting for another player, and at that game I saw Henrik playing, and he directly impressed me very much, and I went back to Holland and I told the president to try to buy him as quick as possible.
It was a dream move. 3 weeks later, 21-year-old Larsson was a Feyenoord player. These were heady days for Henrik. happy in Holland and sensational for Sweden, helping them to third place in USA 94. The good times didn't last forever though, especially when a new coach arrived at Feyenoord.
With Ari Hahn, you know, he didn't have the chemistry. I don't think they were talking to each other. I saw how Henrik felt, you know, not only on the pitch, but also, you know, away from the pitch, you know. Yeah, I think we talked a lot of time about Ari Hahn, and, you know, you could see he wasn't enjoying it. But, you know, sometimes that happens in football, and then you have to move along. His main reason to go was to enjoy his football again, because, you know, if you're not enjoying it, you're not going to be at your top form.
No major club, though, was showing much interest in the unhappy Larsson, and his only option seemed to be a transfer back home.
We were very close. And then it happened that Wim Jensen came to Celtic, and with their old relations. I mean, then for Henrik, when he got a very good offer from Celtic to come, I understood him completely that he made that choice.
Ben went on about Henrik Larsson all the time. I said, what's he like? And he just smiled and says, this guy can play. He's known him since he was a kid. Great attitude to football. And just, he'll come in, he'll score goals.
But it wasn't all plain sailing in Rotterdam. Henrik took Feyenoord to court to allow him to leave the club for £650,000.
I remember him when he got the news, you know, that he went away, you know, he was, you know, screaming in the air and jumping, you know, on his knees and, you know, really celebrating that he could leave.
I've seen a lot of Scottish football on television back in Holland. And, of course, you see a fantastic arena here, so, I mean, it was interesting to come to Scotland and play for Celtic. All the fans, as soon as he signed, said, make sure they don't win 10 in a row.
He realised how important it was to people here in Scotland, Celtic fans especially, that had to stop Rangers winning.
His first league game was at Easter Road against Hibs.
He wasn't fully fit when he came to the club, so we put him on the bench, and midway in the second half we stuck him on just to see how he would do.
How he did is legend. Henrik produced a howler as glaring as the Celtic change strip of the day.
Larsson picks up, gives it away. Chick Charlie, 25 yards from goal!
His first touch, he gave the ball away, and Chick Charlie scored from about 35 yards. But Henrik, he came in and apologised to the player, said, sorry, not happening again. And he's never been that far back since.
It was an inglorious start, to say the least. Another defeat the following week, and Janssen's team were hurtling towards another crisis. Rangers, it seemed, were on their way to a record-breaking 10 championships in a row. Then suddenly, Larsson found his feet, or rather, his head.
Supporting through the middle, Donnelly on the right. Here's Larsson! He's done it! Right on the
line! Celtic have scored! It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me. And I'm feeling good.
Limerick and Celtic were up and running in the league, and they were in the final of the League Cup against Dundee United at Ibrox.
It was an unbelievable occasion. We'd done well to reach the cup final and eventually to win it. It was a really nice day.
Henrik Larsson takes a deflection!
So, a first trophy for Janssen's team, the Coca-Cola Cup. Now for the real thing.
We'd been written off most of the year and fought ourselves back into the title running, and we were leading going into the last game, and we had to win the game. It was just an unbelievable pressure. That day, I think, we were all having a few extra whizzes to the toilet.
And it wasn't long before Wim's man entered Celtic's folklore.
Henrik Larsson. Donnelly's alongside him. Larsson lining up for the shot! What a start for Celtic! 2 minutes gone! And Larsson makes the breakthrough!
And the rest, as they say, is history.
In for Harold Brattbach! Harold Brattbach scores the goal, which may well give Celtic the title. The long wait is over. Celtic have won the championship, and the party can now commence.
It was an unbelievable first season for Henrik and his wife Magdalena.
He started off brilliantly with his goal. People say like, foreign players come in, they don't know a lot about the club. But Henrik grasped it right away, and as you say, he's been a true Celtic.
It's very important for the club, for the fans especially. Celtic done it in the past 9 in a row, so that would mean that Rangers would only be the second club to do it. So it was very important that season.
That goal in the last game this season set Henrik Larsson up to be one of the Celtic greats.
I knew he was a very good player, but I couldn't imagine that he should be so great at Celtic in the coming years.
But Wim wasn't to be around for the coming years. He walked out after winning the championship. The big fear was that his prodigy would follow.
You're always worried in case, you know, player management come in and take away the players that they have with them. He always said he worked well with Feyenoord, so you know each other really well, but luckily for us, Henrik stayed.
But he's not the type of player who would take the huff and say, well, I'm going to walk out. He signed the contract, and he's always been a man of his word. I think he worked as hard for any manager as he did for Wim Jansen, so that's great credit to him.
A new season, a new manager, but no trophies under Dr. Joe Venglis, the sixth manager in 7 years. Constant, however, were Henrik's goals, including his first and his second against Rangers. The following season saw the arrival of the dream team of Kenny Dalglish and John Barnes, and Henrik had hit form. 12 goals in 12 games.
Here comes Henrik Larsson. A wonderful strike by Larsson. And that's the magnificent seven.
5 days later, Henrik was in France for a UEFA Cup match against Lyon.
That's for Blanc. Quick control. Back goes Larsson to make the challenge. Henrik Larsson looks as if he is in big trouble.
It was a freak accident, and I was sitting commentating it, and I could see straight away that was a broken shin.
My heart just sunk at the time, because it's one of your friends and one of the greatest players ever, and seeing his leg in that mess, everyone was upset about it. Even I think it went round the whole ground, because after that, the atmosphere just went really flat.
Henrik always had a thought that this was just half a year that he had to get over, and then he would be back to his best. And I had my doubts, and I'm sure a lot of the doctors and the other players had the doubts that he would be back to his best.
Torment for Dalglish and torment for Barnes as his star striker was sidelined. Celtic hit an all-time low. But just 6 months after the horrific leg break, the Swedish superstar made a comeback for Celtic in the under-21s and was ready to play for his country in Euro 2000.
Recovering so fast that he did, we kept the door open for him into the last minute, and I think he was very pleased about that. And he showed us in the training camp before the Euro 2000 finals that he was qualified to be in the squad.
And DiBiagio's given the ball away, and Kenneth Anderson with Larsson going through, and the flag stays down. Henrik Larsson for Sweden. Rantoldo, a goal!
One interested spectator of the European Championships was Celtic's new boss, Martin O'Neill.
I'd heard of Henrik before, and while he was involved in Euro 2000, he was really just trying to recover from his broken leg. And we opened up the season against Dundee United. And suddenly his ball's played into him, he's turned, and he said this delightful little whip across the box and into the far corner. And that was the first goal that he scored in my time here. But he was off and running, which is very, very important to me. For 4 years, he hasn't stopped running.
a total individual goal. It was just class.
Certainly surprised when he got his hair cut that it was front page, but I think he looks a hell of a lot better with it short, to be honest. We even thought about pinning him down and cutting it.
That probably made him jump another couple of inches higher. Good for my game, as he has for you know the other strikers who have played as well. He looks to play off another striker, but he can adapt his game to different conditions.
When Henrik and Chris play up front together, I think they've got a really good understanding. They really complement each other well. They seem to be on a wavelength, and they say that about great partnerships. When it looks like you're struggling and not much is happening for you or going in your favour, he'll produce a bit of magic and something out of nothing. It'll win you the game, and not many players can do that. And Henrik's one of those world-class players that can.
He's very, very natural. You know, he can dribble, he can shoot, he can head a ball left foot, right foot, he can take a ball, you know, anyhow, and nothing surprises me.
I don't know where that came from. I'm sure he's a wee bit superstitious.
Winning the CIS Cup was a great way to kick off the treble. We had Chris Sutton sent off.
I think it was 1-0 at that stage, so I was feeling a bit, you know, guilty.
Henrik's goals were simply sublime.
I remember him going round the keeper and a little drag over the ball. And they're the things that separate Henrik, because not many strikers would think about doing a dummy and sending the keeper for pie and chips.
Fantastic from Henrik, you know, a hat-trick and you know, a cup victory. I felt very relieved.
I'm sure that evening you go back home and think, well, I think I did pretty well there today.
Scottish champions! Larson! Brilliant!
Everybody's been on about the treble, and it's a great feeling. This was the one I haven't won yet in Scotland, but we managed to win it today, so I'm very, very pleased.
Three trophies out of three, and one still to come. 18 months after breaking his leg, Henrik was named Europe's top scorer.
Massive total. Can you believe you did that?
No, not really. We need a little bit of luck as well, and good teammates as well, so I'm pleased with that.
Now Henrik was ready to conquer the world at Japan and Korea 2002.
Here's Larson, surely Larson! That's what he does best, Henrik Larson of Celtic.
Despite scoring against Senegal, Sweden went out of the competition and Henrik sought out the manager.
In his very calm way, he just came over and said that it's getting more and more tough to play both in Celtic and in the national team, so now it's finished.
Celtic hoisted the league flag for the second championship under Martin O'Neill, and Henrik hoisted his goals tally as domestic service was resumed in 2002.
Larson! Something special from Larson!
But it was in Europe that Henrik was looking to make his mark. And what better stage than a Battle of Britain match against Blackburn Rovers?
What can Celtic make of this? Thompson corner kick! They can score! And Henrik!
a 1-0 lead against the run of play. But the motivation for the second leg came from a surprising source. Ewood Park a fortnight later.
He's done it again! His 22nd European goal 2 weeks ago, his 23rd at Ewood Park.
Men nil, boys two.
Harry, you didn't just win, you just played magnificently as a team throughout.
Yeah, I have to say we played shit the first game at Parkhead. We wanted to show today that we're a better side than a lot of comments we heard from different Blackburn players. But yeah, they should learn them a lesson, never talk until the game is finished.
Hendrick was out after breaking his jaw against Livingston. Surprisingly, he was back within 4 weeks, ready for a semi-final clash with Boavista.
Lennon's cross, Leo, by Petrov, and Larson scores!
But with the game tied at 1-1.
Great strikers that miss chances, I think they probably are hard on themselves, yeah. And I think Henrik's no different.
The other players look up to him, and if he misses a chance or, you know, he missed a penalty, you know, nobody's going to say anything to him because we realise, you know, he's such a big player, and he, one thing about him is he'll always stand up to be counted and, you know, get on with it with the next chance.
And that's exactly what he did in the return leg.
It's now Larson. Larson, hard to the medical, but Larson must be! It is!
And Celtic are in the UEFA final. And Henrik Larsson is the man who almost inevitably scored the one goal.
Sutty laid it off and I tried to sneak it into John, but fortunate for us, he slide tackled into my path again, took a touch and got it in the net.
Many people do devalue his performance or his record and what have you because he's playing in the Scottish Premier League, and you just have to look at his record in European competition, in the UEFA Cup, in the Champions League, and internationally when he's played for Sweden in the World Cups. He's scored goals at the top level against the top defenders. And he's done it against Premiership teams, so what's to say that he wouldn't do it week in, week out like he has up here?
Larson's goal directed Celtic to Seville for the UEFA Cup final against Porto.
Agat's cross. Larson's header! It's 1-1! The left foot of Alan Thompson. Larson! He's done it again! Absolutely incredible!
Two each, but an extra time, disaster struck.
Here's Dearley with the chance! Dearley scores for Porto! And is that the goal which deprives Celtic of the UEFA Cup?
There was an emptiness about it. It was a magnificent performance, and one that you can play back in video when he retires and say, look at that, look at those goals, magnificent. But of course, the emptiness comes from the fact is that we didn't win it.
We lost this here tonight, and it's no joy whatsoever. Everybody is very, very hurt, but we have to get on with it.
Everybody was, you know, obviously devastated. Looking back on it, you feel more sorry for Henrik than anybody else for the performance he put in, you know, that night.
He called me and his dad, his brother. He invited us down there. Right after the finals, he calls me up and asks me, how has it been? I mean, it's more like the person he's always taking care of everybody. And he has a big heart.
And it was double disappointment 3 days later when Celtic lost their league title by a goal difference of one. The width of a post, in fact. It's his swan song season at Celtic Park, and the fans' adoration just goes on and on and on.
He's idolised here by the crowd for all the praise that Henrik Larsson has got since he arrived in Scotland, and for what he's done for the football club. He's more than deserving of it.
I'm mad about the boy.
The man of my dreams.
And I know it's stupid. to be mad about the boy.
He's been a phenomenon, absolute phenomenon. Don't think we'll ever see his likes again.
The sleepless nights I've had about the boy.
He's a normal guy. He's a friendly character. He's certainly a good father and a good husband, and he loves spending time with his family. He enjoys getting out, having a game of golf and walking his dogs. He's a normal guy.
Early in the morning, just be careful what you say to him. You know, he can be a bit sharp first thing in the morning. So I wouldn't like to be married to him.
People I know as a player, but I like him as a guy. He's good fun as well as being a great player.
One day, my locker was closed and I've come in and opened it and he's jumped out and I nearly, well, I'm not saying what I need, but it was totally unexpected. I just didn't expect that.
This year, Henrik won his fourth league medal in 7 years with Celtic. The charismatic Swede broke another club record when he overtook Stevie Chalmers to become Celtic's third highest goal scorer in the club's history behind Jimmy McGrory and Bobby Lennox.
If he stayed next year, he would bypass my record, and I wish he would stay next year and bypass it so the Celtic support would bring to more glory next year, and that would be a fact if Henrik stayed.
Henrik Larsson.
Suddenly back in Sweden, there was much singing and dancing. Larsson had changed his mind about never again playing for his country.
It's of course very positive, and he's a very good character to have in the squad, both on and off the pitch, so we are very happy.
But any hope that he might follow suit for Celtic was quickly dashed.
We have spoken to him in the previous 6 months or whatever, like this season, and said to him, go on, Eric, give him another season. But he's made his mind up.
Playing with drink and see what happens, but no, he's very set in his ways.
Henrik's last competitive match at Celtic Park brought 60,000 fans to an emotion-filled stadium.
Guess I've come to live here in your eyes. This must be the place called paradise. You are so precious to me. What a special time within our lives. And I guess I've come to live here in your eyes.
You know, all the players will be sad to see him go. You know, definitely. I think that'll hit us more at the start of next season.
Certainly, the biggest miss is going to be on the pitch. That's for sure. But we won't be able to judge how much he's missed until it actually occurs. You know,
Henrik's choice is to leave this football club after 7 glorious years, and I don't think anybody would begrudge him that. Yet. What he has done for the football club has been phenomenal. He'll never be forgotten. That's the good news.
And so to the Scottish Cup, and Henrik's dearest wish, to leave the Celtic fans with another trophy. And he didn't disappoint.
Hello and a very warm welcome to Sports Scene for the climax of the domestic season, the Tennent Scottish Cup final. We've also got highlights from Cardiff of the FA Cup to come, plus a fantastic and unique opportunity for fans of Celtic, and more specifically, Henrik Larsson, so stick around. Gordon Smith and Derek White were at the National Stadium this afternoon, and we'll hear their dulcet tones later on. But first, to the action. It was Dunfermline's day in the sun, competing in their first Scottish Cup final in a generation, against a Celtic side aiming to become the most successful team in the competition's history. With the microphones and the sunblock, here's Derek White and Rob McLean.
Dunfermline making one alteration to the side which lost 3-2 to Rangers last Sunday. Darren Young fit again, and he returns to central midfield. Lee Bullen is the player to drop out of the starting lineup. A difficult decision for Jimmy Calderwood to come to. No place either for Andy Todd, another defender whose height and bulk could have been useful, you would think. Scott Wilson and Scott Thompson are long-term absentees. Noel Hunt is injured. Greg Shields is cup-tied. 20-year-old Aaron Labonte makes only his 10th start. And Richie Byrne, he's 22, holds on to the left-back berth. And it's same again, Celtic. This is the team which beat Dundee United live on the BBC last Sunday. It's as strong as Celtic get if you count out John Hartson, who's not quite ready to make his return to the big stage. 19-year-old keeper David Marshall rounds off a fairy tale season with his first Scottish Cup final appearance. Stan Varga has just signed a 2-year extension to his contract. What a signing he's been for no transfer fee. And it's a last competitive appearance, as we've been saying, in a Celtic shirt for 240-goal Henrik Larsson. It's Stuart Dougal's first major final. And he, of course, is heading off soon to be one of the fourth officials at Euro 2004. Can Dunfermline do what they last did in 1968 and win the Scottish Cup? The 2004 final underway. Dunfermline boosted by the fact that they've beaten both Celtic and Rangers this season. The first threat from Didier Agat. Neil Lennon. Stylian Petrov. Agat gets it back from Petrov. And that's a good block from Richie Byrne.
Yeah, an instant threat there, Rob, from the pace of Agat down the right-hand side.
The turn and shot from Chris Sutton, and Derek Stilley solidly behind it.
Yeah, throw into feet there, quick turn, great touch, first touch for Chrissy Sutton, and well done, Derek Stilley, that'll give him plenty of confidence at the start of the match.
Brewster gets on the end of the clearance, also gets a free kick. We've our ball back. It's Gunny Dempsey, it's deflected, and it's not far away.
Well, great technique here, just gets his right foot bent round it. Oh, I tell you what, well, that's not far away.
A header well won by Brewster. In goes Derek Young and Gary Dempsey, and Stevie Crawford blazes the effort too high, and what a chance this was.
Yeah, that's going to go down as a big chance. That's going to be a great contest, great flick up from Brewster, great interplay there. It just doesn't go over it enough, and he shanks it wide.
Agat aiming for Larsson, down for Varga. That's a great challenge, well won by Andreas Skirla. And Nicholson, that's given away. Straight at Balde. That plays his team right into trouble. Larsson. Stilley comes for it. There was hesitation between Skirla and Stilley, and that could have been very serious for Dunfermline.
Yeah, that's when you need that. That's when you need a shout. Great play from Henrik Larsson. You need a clear shout from the goalkeeper because the hesitation, because it did cause them all sorts of problems.
That's the way penalties are sometimes conceded. And Chris Sutton thought he was in with a shout, but I think Stuart Dougal got that right.
Yeah, it was a good position, Stuart Dougal, as well, to see that one.